Hey everyone, Brendan Snyder here. How are you? Thanks so much for joining me and welcome to another episode of New Music Finds. It's one of my favorite series to do because I get to go through all the new stuff that I've just picked up. I get them from different places like my local record store. And you guys just saw that I did a Let's Go to the Record Store from Princeton Record Exchange. I've got those things here. I also get this stuff online from eBay, Amazon, and other places like that. So a little bit of everything. I've got 12 things to run through with you. Some new releases, some catalog releases, new, used, a little bit of everything here. And we'll get into that in just a bit. But before we start, if you're new to my channel and haven't already hit the subscribe button, please do. Also, leave a comment, hit like. All those things do help support my channel. And of course, if you turn on notifications, you're going to stay up to date on everything going on this channel, but also in the music world where we're going through new releases, but other videos and things that I have about new music news coming out and album release schedules and record store day and all that great stuff. So please turn on notifications so you can stay up to date on all of that. All right, so I always like to kick off with new releases, and this was one that I didn't even know was coming out, but when I did my What Just Dropped video, I found this one and immediately went and ordered it. It's a new Queen album, not new studio. It's a compilation. It's called Kizuna. It's a Japanese-only release, and it collects together three different live concerts or tracks from those concerts. So we got Killers Live, Live at the Hollywood Bowl, and Live at Wembley. Wembley was 86. I forget the year of the other two, but it's like 79, 82, 86. So roughly in that vein. And all of the songs on here feature Freddie Mercury, so you are getting a consistent release live show with him. We got 16 tracks on here. A lot of big songs on here that you would expect, but it's also got a few lesser-known things on here. The fact that it moves through the years is actually what's really interesting, and it doesn't do it chronologically. It does it as the way a live show would be, but it jumps around via the year, and I like that actually. And I have to say, they pick some really good versions of songs to appear on this release. I think it's also one of those hybrid CDs, so if you're into that sort of thing, you're kind of getting a bonus where you're ordering, you know, the Japanese release, but you're getting something a little more with it. Don't know that that's going to get any kind of wider release. Completely ran under the radar for me. Didn't even know it was coming out, like I said, until I did a little more digging during the What Just Dropped series and found that, which I got to say, that's another one of my favorite series to do for you guys because I dig up all these things that I didn't even know was coming out. And usually I do my pre-orders and I get my stuff on Friday and then I compile the video for What Just Dropped on Friday to release on Saturday. But from Friday, I find more stuff and I usually get, you know, two-day delivery or something, and I get more stuff on Saturday or Sunday, which is always fun. All right, another new release, Steve Hackett, former guitarist for Genesis, and his new album called The Circus and the Night Whale. It is a concept album. It's kind of, you know, trials and tribulations of the main character having sort of a moment, and don't know the ins and outs of the whole thing there, but 13 tracks that are on here. And I gotta say, when I first checked out the individual songs, they didn't do a whole lot for me. I didn't end up ordering it to get it on Friday on release day. It was something that I chose to buy after because I saw it in a record store and I thought, hey, you know, this is staring me right in the face. And you know, sometimes you walk in the store and you see something and you weren't expecting to buy it, but you're kind of like, I kind of really want that right now. Well, this was one of those. And after getting it and playing it, I have to say I've really warmed up to it. I'm enjoying it a lot more. You know, Steve Hackett, his music, this album here in particular, very prog-oriented. The time signatures on the songs really put it into that sense of what is prog. So it's not just complex playing, it's also the time signatures and stuff, which if you're not in the mood for prog, can be a little jarring, I have found. So it's one of those things that maybe when I heard the singles, didn't really do it for me because I wasn't in the mood for that. Getting it home, giving it a chance, and about the second listen, I really started to warm up to it. So now I'm really glad that I've got it in the collection. Last few weeks, been digging a lot into 60s rock, Blue Cheer, Iron Butterfly, Quicksilver Messenger Service, a lot of different bands from that era, pulling out and listening to stuff like Steppenwolf and the Grassroots and, you know, I don't know, you name it, the Kinks and a whole bunch more. So I course, still in the mood for that, and I managed to find this Quicksilver Messenger Service Rare Tracks, which had come out, I think it came out late 2023, and part of a box set that they had already had out. So not the first time it's released, but as a standalone disc, it is the first time. And I really wasn't interested in it when it first dropped, but then I got into the 60s stuff and I was really grooving on it. And so finding that turned out to be the perfect thing. And it's mostly stuff from 67 before their debut album. It's got a few tracks from, I think, 68, 69 on there. But I have to say the sequence of it, the versions that they are, which are alternate editions, early demos, that sort of stuff, works really well. The sound quality is fantastic on it. And I wasn't expecting that. I thought, okay, you know, it's a Cleopatra Records kind of thing. They're probably scraping the bottom of the barrel, or this stuff would have been available before. And no, it's actually really, really good. So if you've been, you know, on the fence about this and you've been wanting some 60s rock, Quicksilver Messenger Service Rare Tracks, it's a pretty good find. Okay, as I said, I went to Princeton Record Exchange. I had a 3-day weekend, so I definitely wanted to hit up my local record store and get some new stuff to just have to dive into. And if you watched that video and you heard me talk about it, where I was kind of in a musical lull and I didn't have anything that was really speaking to me, and then I go to the record store, and this of course always happens, I walk out with a whole bunch of different stuff that I wasn't expecting to pick up. And that speaks to me, and then I'm on, you know, down a whole new rabbit hole and musical path and everything, and that's exactly what happened here. So one of the ones that I was just adding to have in the collection, because I had it on a twofer already, but I didn't have it as a standalone, and certainly not like this, Rock Candy Records reissue, was the John Waite Ignition, his debut solo album, 1982. Producer for this is the guitar player Neil Giraldo, who plays with Pat Benatar. Of course, he's also Pat Benatar's husband now, but he was from that band. This debut album, I didn't remember it being so rock, so hard rock for what it is for 1982. And it's really good. Getting it for $5.99, still sealed new, Rock Candy Records reissue, and not having to pay the $17, $18 that these things normally are, was such a great deal. But I probably hadn't listened to this album in a very long time. Like I said, I did have, you know, the first two albums on a disc and the second two albums on another disc. But getting it as a standalone thing has kind of given me some new insight and some new appreciation for it. And I got to say, this has just been the perfect thing. I've been listening to this over and over and over. And I just really don't remember this album in particular speaking to me that way when I first heard it. Next up was one that I have on vinyl, and I only picked up recently, maybe listened to it once or twice. Again, didn't really speak to me at the time. I bought it for who the members are. Found this as a Wounded Bird Records reissue, and decided to just pick it up because it was $5.99. Detective, debut studio album featuring Tony Kaye on keyboards from Yes and Flash, probably another, you know, bunch of other projects and stuff. This release is 1977, so it's before he returns to Yes in, you know, I don't know, 83 for OU812. No, that's Van Halen. 90125. You know, it's one of those, right? All the numbered albums. But anyways, you know, Owner of a Lonely Heart, that period of Yes. And in between that time frame, Tony Kaye did a lot of different stuff. He also did One Live Badger, which I thought was fantastic. Or the called Badger was the album, but One Live Badger. Michael Desbars is on here. And he was part of Silverado, you know, totally spacing on it. Oh, here we go. Silverhead. There he goes. Right next to me is something I could easily pull out and show you guys. So I know him from some different things like that. He had a solo album out. Of course, he was an actor on the TV show A-Team. But, you know, coming from this band here, and I never really paid attention much before, but this has a very Led Zeppelin-style vibe in the guitar work, the song structure to this, and even the vocal styles are a lot like Robert Plant's. And I don't know if that was intentional or that's just what I'm hearing today. So I bought it for Tony Kaye because I'm a huge fan of Yes. Doesn't really sound anything like that, but turned out to be really good. So I was very glad about that. That one turned out to be very, very good and exciting. I picked up two Christopher Cross album. So the debut album, self-titled, and this one here, which is Another Page, second studio album. So interesting, this one here is what they call a Target CD. And I don't really know much about that. I'm going to have to Google it. If you guys know, you can leave a word in the comment. But I was told at the store, because there was an entire section of Target CDs, and no, we're not talking about the store. They're a higher end CD, much like the Mobile Fidelities or the HD CD and the SA CDs and all those other ones. They told me it was along those lines. It's a better recorded or a better transferred type of music. I've never heard of the Target CD before, but they must have had 10 different albums like that. This was in there. It was only $5.99, and I've never seen this one on CD. I've seen this one a lot, never owned this one, have this one on vinyl, but I was really glad to go ahead and get both of these at the same time. And I have to say, I'm actually really enjoying this. I got to be in the right mood for Christopher Cross. Definitely mellow. He's that yacht rock sort of sounding stuff, the soft rock. But when I'm in the mood for it, it's some great music. And of course, it just totally takes me right back to the 80s, that whole yuppie scene and everything, which I grew up with. So I do love that stuff. All right, this one here was kind of the big find of the day. Maybe doesn't move me as much as these others here, but I've long wanted this one on CD and in my collection. And I know I'm the oddball out in this, but I've always been a big fan of Ringo Starr. I like his stuff, and I like the variety in his albums. This one in particular, Ringo the Fourth, which I think was his sixth studio album, so it wasn't his fourth. I did do some reading on it. The idea of Ringo the Fourth was a tie into him being the fourth member of the Beatles, maybe the fourth in his most commercial albums, because he also did a country album and a throwback album of some pop standards and stuff like that. But this here is actually a disco-infused sort of dance-sounding album, which I really like. I've had it on vinyl for a while, never seen the CD before. This is on Atlantic Records, so an original pressing, not a reissue on some off label. Very glad to get it. It was $20, but I thought that was a very good deal. Definitely worked for me. I'm okay with that. This is one I had seen at the store a couple times, passed it by, glad to see it was still there. I think it was $5.99 or so. Frank Marino, Mahogany Rush, a best of on the Razor and Tie label, covering a good amount of their career. It omits some of that proggy early stuff. Starts with Rush 4, and then we cover other things like World Anthem, Tales of the Unexpected, What's Next, and my favorite album called Juggernaut. They even cover that on here. And it's got some live stuff, some jams. It's got some stuff from the California Jam, which is not an album that he has out, but a compilation that was out at the time, so they pulled that. So you're getting some outside stuff that's not available on any Mahogany Rush albums on here. Made it more interesting and worth picking up for that reason. But, you know, sometimes I don't want to just pull out one album and listen to that. And my kind of go-to is the Juggernaut album. And I don't often venture too far outside of that, even though I have pretty much the whole catalog, minus like the first three albums and then everything going forward from there. One day I'll probably even pick up those early proggy ones. But, you know, sometimes it's nice just to have a compilation to throw on. And then you can hear songs from these other albums that maybe you weren't focusing on before. And when you go back to those albums, you end up knowing something like you know the hit, because I didn't grow up with this stuff. So it's all, you know, new to me for the first time. I'm coming at Frank Marino, Mahogany Rush, really just because I've always heard about him, but I've actually never heard a single song on the radio or know anything from it. It was just kind of one of those things that one day I was in the right mood for some blues, hard rock guitar, and it clicked. And I actually started with the Juggernaut album. That was a great first one for me. All right, found a Graham Nash solo album from 2002 on the Artemis Records label, which is now defunct and gone and very hard to come by. It's also why I think it's not available on streaming services, so I didn't even know this existed. This one here called Songs for Survivors, and pulled it out, wasn't sure what it was, Googled it, found out it's actually an original album. It's not a compilation or live or anything like that. And I thought, geez, how have I not known about this? I would have tracked this down a long time ago. Out of all the Crosby, Stills, Nash, and Young, well, I mean, I Neil Young's probably my favorite out of those four, but Crosby, Stills, and Nash. Graham Nash has always been my favorite. I really like his vocal style. And surprisingly, ended up really liking all his solo stuff. I've tried the David Crosby, like a little bit. I've got one of his albums, Thousands Road. Stephen Stills is someone I've never been able to get into outside of Crosby, Stills, and Nash. So go figure, don't really know why that is. Maybe somewhere down the road I'll be more into that stuff, but it's kind of where it stands, and Graham Nash is the one for me, sort of like Ringo Starr is the main guy out of the Beatles that I happen to like. I'm the oddball out, but you know, music is a little different for everyone. And for me, I've got my personal favorites, just like I'm sure you've got your personal favorites. Next one up. This one was also a cool score. It was the first thing that I pulled out, literally the first CD I pulled out and found, and immediately was like, score for the day. If I go home with nothing else, this one is it. Robert Barry. And this is called Pilgrimage to a Point, and you can see the artwork on here is trying to do sort of a Roger Dean style thing like Asia and Yes album artwork that Roger Dean does. It's on the SPV label, distributed by the Griffin Music label. Robert Barry being from the band 3, which featured Keith Emerson and Carl Palmer. Was a kind of a continuation of Emerson, Lake, and Palmer, but done differently because Robert Barry came into the fold. And picked this up simply based on that. I've got some other Robert Barry stuff. What I didn't know was Steve Howe plays on a number of these tracks, co-wrote two of the songs. You got some other key people in here. This album is phenomenal. Basically, imagine a Lost Asia album with Steve Howe that Robert Barry is fronting. And probably if I go back and dig, because I think he was briefly a member, or maybe he tried out or was going to be and then didn't. But very cool, I gotta say. I've really been digging that. And then this one here was a very cool one. LP replica version of Poco and their album Ghost Town on Atlantic Records. I have this one on a threefer from the BGO label, this album plus two others. And I can't remember whether this is the first one or second or third or something, but sometimes, you know, albums like this will get buried in the middle and I'm putting it on and I kind of never make it through past the first album, which is why I don't like to have those ones where two on one disc or three on two discs or something, because so if I want to just hear this, I want to be able to pull it out, pop it on, and not be muddied by an album that came before or after it. So currently on the path to replace those, always am, in fact. So found this, very glad. This is actually one of the Poco albums that I knew that I did like. And so I was really glad to get it by itself. So in all, I'm just kind of digging through this real quick. You know, I managed to find two albums to replace. This might have been $7.99, I think. This was $5.99, but all in all, it's easy to replace an album when they're only that inexpensive. Whereas the first time I bought them around, I probably paid the full price, the $15.99 give or take kind of a thing. And if I can find them used for not very much, not only do I like that better and feel better about it in the collection, but I can now listen to these albums independently and not feel like I spent an arm and a leg doing that. I'm not going out and shelling out, you know, 20, 30, 40 bucks to buy it because it's rare. If I can find it, even though these are rare albums, if I can find them inexpensively like this through a used record store search, like at Princeton Record Exchange, it's even better. And so I had a really good time digging through all that stuff. I hope you enjoyed that video of Let's Go to the Record Store and the whole trials and tribulations of digging through the snow and getting there 2 hours early and having to wait. And, you know, it's just one of those days. But I walked out with some good stuff. And onward and upward to next week, where we're finally having our first sort of big musical release day. Ace Frehley's dropping a new album. Mick Mars is dropping his album. I know there's a few other things in there. Super excited about that. Interestingly, a few of those things got pushed back. So what was looking like a monstrous release week is actually pushed back, I think, only 1 week to the following week. And then that one might have only had four or five, is now like 10 things. So for the next 2 weeks, you're going to see lots of new releases purchased by me. And hopefully we'll get back into doing some album reviews and things, because now we're going to have some really killer albums and stuff that I know you're going to want to know about. Plus myself, I like to dig into these things. And if I'm digging into it for myself, I'd love to pass on that knowledge to you guys. So Keep an eye out for that. New episodes of New Music Finds every Wednesday, so check back for that sort of stuff. And of course, stick around for all the other great stuff that's in there. I like to do stuff with Anthony Covielli at Sound Exchange. You get those discussion topics. You get new music or music news roundup on Fridays and what just dropped, talking about all the new releases on Saturdays. And it just kind of goes from there. So that's it. Have a good one, guys, and I'll talk to you real soon. Bye-bye.